Alright, hi everyone. I hope you guys are having a great day. So, first of all, remember that exam 3 is going to close on April 11th at noon, so at 12 p.m. So, make sure to take exam 3 before it closes. And then, after exam 3 closes, I will be going in and adding the points for attending the Active Minds event, as well as making sure that everyone got full credit for the opinion questions. So, that will end the third section of the class. The fourth section of the class will talk about things like relationships, love, attraction, as well as prejudice, and then also a little bit on aggression. So the fourth section of the class will cover that material, and then we will have exam 4 that will cover that material. So remember that exam 4 is the required proctored exam. So you need to make sure that you have made an appointment and that you're going to be taking that with an appropriate proctor, because that exam will be password protected. So you will need to be at a proctoring service to take that. Okay. So if you have any questions or any issues with that, let me know. So what will happen is that after exam 4, I will post everyone's grade in the class before the final exam. Remember that there are 5 exams, 4 throughout the semester, and then the final exam, and that you get 1 drop grade for exams. So what this means is that some students will not take the final exam. I'll post your grade before the final, you'll be happy with that, and you'll decide to use the final exam as your drop grade. Some students will want to try to boost their grade, and so you can use the final exam to try to do that. So the final exam cannot hurt you, because if it ends up being your lowest exam grade, I'll just drop it. And so your grade won't go down, but it could potentially go up. Okay. So if you have any questions about the ways that grades are going to be calculated, feel free to let me know. Feel free to come by my office hours. I would be happy to help. So today we are going to start off the fourth section of the class by talking about love and attraction. So we talk about close relationships in social psychology because social psychology is all about how we are influenced by other people and how we influence other people. And there may be no relationships that are more influential than those close romantic relationships. So we'll talk about how those relationships form this week, and we'll talk a little bit about love. Next week we will finish the material on love and attraction and introduce prejudice as well. Okay? So if you need anything, let me know. Otherwise, we're going to go ahead and get started. So as I said, this week we're going to focus on interpersonal relationships. And so when we start talking about close romantic relationships, we're going to start off by talking about attraction. And we start by talking about attraction because relationships typically start here, right? So there is something, whether it be a physical attraction or something else about a person that draws you in that makes you want to create a relationship with that person. And so before we can talk about close relationships, we have to talk about how we choose the people that we want to have relationships with. So we're going to talk about several factors that influence who we find attractive. One determinant of interpersonal attraction is proximity, or as you'll see on the next slide, propinquity. But proximity here is just the idea that the more you see someone, the more time you spend with them, the more likely you are to be attracted to them. So typically, not always, we end up forming relationships with the people that we see a lot. People who perhaps are our neighbors, that live in the same apartment complex, that take the same classes, that run in the same circle of friends. Now, this used to be for certain the norm when people didn't have as much of access to people who were in other locations. Today, this may not happen as often because we have things like the internet that allow us to talk to people halfway around the world. But it is still important. The amount of time that we spend with someone is an important part of whether or not we find that person attractive and whether or not we develop a relationship with them. So this is called the propinquity effect, the finding that the more we see and interact with people, the more likely we are to become friends. So maybe perhaps you've had a situation where you've met a person and you didn't like them as much at first, and then the more time you spent with them, the more you liked them. I had a situation when I was an undergraduate. There was a person who was in a lot of my classes, and I just didn't click with this person. There was just something about her that rubbed me the wrong way. We just didn't get along, or at least from my perspective, we didn't get along. We never fought. I just didn't particularly like her. But then later on, we ended up working together on a group project and actually became friends. And it was because the more time we spent together, the more I realized that those characteristics that I thought were bothersome to me or were annoying to me or whatever, I had misjudged her, right? That she was really much more genuine than I thought that she was. I made mistakes, and sometimes when we make first impressions, we don't always get it right. Sometimes we make mistakes. So the more time we spend with someone, the more likely we are to find things in common with them. Also, people we spend a lot of time with, we are motivated to like them. If I'm going to have to be in class with you or in a group project with you, if I'm going to have to be neighbors with you, that kind of thing, then we feel like it's important for us and we become invested in finding a way to get along with that person. And that also makes relationships more likely to develop, not just romantic relationships, but also friends and acquaintances as well. The idea here is that mere exposure is what is causing this effect. The finding that the more exposure we have to a stimulus, the more apt we are to like it, the more likely we are to enjoy it. So this goes for people. The more time we spend with a person, you know, the frequency with which we see them plays a role. But not just with people as well, right? Maybe the first time you try a certain kind of food, you didn't like it. Or the first time you try a certain drink, you don't like it. But the more you're exposed to it, the more you like it, right? We see this with lots of different things. And so perhaps the more time we spend around people, we find common ground and we actually find that we like each other. So proximity is an important part of who we find attractive, probably because of the mere exposure effect. Also, just convenience, right? So the activity this week, building on this idea of what it is that causes us to be attracted to someone else, it says take a minute to picture your perfect spouse. And in this activity, I am wanting you to think about a spouse, a long-term partner. I know that your response to this activity could change if we were talking about a short-term partner, but I'm talking about a long-term commitment, right? List the 10 most important characteristics you were looking for, okay, first of all. So think about the characteristics like perhaps physical appearance or personality traits, things like that, and then tell me how many of those apply to you as well, right? So I know that you'll have that in your mind as you make your list, and this might influence your answers. When I do this activity in in-person classes, I typically have them write them down and then afterwards ask them to count how many of them apply to you. Kind of hard to do that in an online class, though. I can't really surprise you guys very much, but tell me how many of those would apply to you, and then in what ways would you want a partner to be similar to you, and in what ways would you want a partner to be different? So there may be some things like your religious beliefs or your political convictions or something like that that you want your partner to agree with you on or to be similar to you on. But there may be some things like perhaps your personality where you think that you would get along better with someone who was a little bit different. So this week I want you to tell me the traits that you're looking for. Now, I do want to get to know you guys, but I don't want to get to know you too well. I have done variations of this activity in other classes before, and you won't believe the answers that I get. So you can say sexy, but let's don't go beyond sexy. Like, I don't need dimensions or anything like that. That's not really the purpose of this activity. You wouldn't believe some of the responses I've gotten before, but I want to know what characteristics you're looking for, and I want to know how you would want your partner to be similar to you and how you would want them to be different from you. The reason that I have you guys think about that this week is because one of the major things that influences whether or not we're attracted to someone is how similar they are to us. And this is going to be a theme that's going to come up again later in the lecture. It says, birds of a feather flock together. We hear that, right? But we also hear opposites attract. So which one of these is true? Well, research overwhelmingly supports similarity in the vast majority of things, right? Especially related to those core values, those core beliefs. We tend to want people who are more similar to us. And relationships where similarity is the norm are actually more likely to be successful. I'm not saying that opposites can't get along and can't have perfectly happy relationships, but what I am saying is that it does cause more conflict, or at least it makes conflict more likely. So conflict just means any time where your opinions or motivations or beliefs or whatever are not lining up with someone else's. And so, if you were in a long-term relationship with someone who was very similar to you in a lot of ways, that could reduce a lot of that conflict, right? So, couples who are very different from each other are going to have to think critically ahead of time about how they are going to resolve those differences when they come up, right? One of the classes that I have taught in the past at Mississippi State and I'm teaching right now is an interpersonal relationships class. And one of the things that we do there is that we have speakers of different religious backgrounds come in and talk about their particular religious beliefs and how those are related to relationships. And something that they all say, regardless of what their religious belief is that it is a lot easier to have a relationship with someone who shares your religious beliefs, especially when you're thinking about potentially having children, and it complicates the situation of how do you want your children to be raised. So similarity is very important. Now, this does not mean that you have to be like exactly like each other. I would say that my husband and I are a lot of our beliefs and opinions do line up very closely, but our personalities probably don't. I am a very type A kind of person, like things a certain way. He's very laid back, and I feel like we complement each other fairly well in that way. Although we've been married for 6.5 years now, I think that he's a little bit more organized since he and I have been together, and I'm a little bit more laid back. So I think we've benefited each other in that way. But it is important to be similar to your partner because it reduces conflict. And this doesn't just go for a romantic partner, but also anyone you're going to be spending a lot of time with. So this picture is an administrator who is working at a college trying to work on roommate applications. Now, I don't know how many of you have had roommates. Just about everyone has a roommate experience at some point. Sometimes this is more successful than others, but roommate relationships are also another situation where similarity is very important, right? If you are someone who goes to bed early and your roommate stays up all night long, that could potentially cause problems. If you're someone who's very messy and your roommate was someone who likes things very neat, also can cause problems here. So similarity is very important. I wouldn't want the job of trying to put people with their roommates. There's a lot of pressure there. All right, so talking about similarity in things like opinions and personality, but also similarity in appearance. It says people tend to seek physical proximity to those who are similar in appearance. You might hear people say that the longer couples are together, the more they start to look like each other, which I'm not sure how that would work out for me because my husband has a big red beard. So anyway, but it says we tend to seek others with a similar degree of physical attractiveness. So I don't know if you guys watched House, but there's a clip from the television show House, super rude, super smart doctor, who was talking to the wife of a patient and commented that he thought that she was much more attractive than her husband. And he said, you know, that it just doesn't make sense, right? Fours marry fours and eights marry eights. And there might be some wiggle room there if somebody gets pregnant or somebody has a lot of money, but for the most part, that's the way it works. It's a very cynical approach, but maybe it's true. I usually ask students about this and I get feedback. A lot of people agree. I suppose the idea here is that these relationships might be a little bit more stable. That if you were with someone who is significantly more attractive than you, then you might be perhaps more worried about infidelity or something like that. That's a lot of the responses that I get from students on this issue, but typically people like to be with other people who are similar to them in their level of attractiveness. Also, it matters how committed you are to the relationship. So notice in the activity that I asked you guys to think about a committed relationship. So I specifically said a spouse. So for a committed relationship, people do tend to choose a similar partner, right? As I said, conflict can abound when there are a lot of differences. However, if it's just a fling where you're not thinking that the relationship is going to last very long, people usually go out of their way to choose dissimilar partners. So I suppose the idea here is that conflict won't have time to develop because you don't intend to spend much time with that person. But spending time with someone different from you could be potentially more exciting or more interesting, and it's okay if it doesn't work out because you've already decided it was a short-term relationship. So perhaps if I had asked you on the activity to list characteristics you were looking for in a fling, you might have listed some very different answers, right? So the amount of commitment that we have, which commitment is just an intention to continue a relationship, right? the amount of commitment that we have definitely plays a role in how similar we want our partners. So other things that play a role in whether or not we are attracted to someone, reciprocal liking. Something is reciprocal. It means you like me, so I like you back. We like people who like us, right? You might have ever been in a situation where there was someone who liked you and you didn't like this person at first, but they liked you and that made you like them more, or it kind of softened how you felt about that person, right? Why is it that we like people who like us? Well, for one thing, it's kind of balanced that way. It is difficult to dislike someone who likes us, but also we like us, right? So now we have something in common. Hey, at least the person has good taste, right? So we tend to like ourselves, and so we value other people who like us as well. It says, for initial attraction, reciprocal liking can overcome dissimilarity. So even if it's a person that you see is very different from you and maybe not the kind of person you ever would have saw yourself with, if they express an interest in you, then you're more likely to find yourself attracted to them and maybe even to someone that you never would have imagined that you would have been with. So some interesting things can happen here when other people like us. Physical attractiveness is an important characteristic, and probably a lot of you will include this in your list. Most people do. I ask the question, is it possible to have a successful relationship with someone that you're not attracted to? Probably the first initial answer is no, and the American answer is no, but perhaps it could be. But physical attractiveness is very important, obviously plays an important role in liking. So sometimes the only thing that we know about a person is what they look like. If it's someone that we haven't met, we haven't spent a lot of time with, then the only thing that we have to go on is their physical attractiveness, or whatever we can see, right? So maybe perhaps the way that they're dressed or the way that they carry themselves, that may be the only thing that we can see. Now, is it fair to make a judgment about someone based solely on their appearance? Well, we'll talk later about how sometimes these beliefs that we have about someone based on their appearance are not accurate, but that's all we have to go on in the situation if you just met the person. Physical attractiveness, obviously very important for an initial liking of that person. Now, we sometimes think that physical attractiveness might be more important to men than it is to women. So typically, when you ask a man and a woman what are their most important traits, maybe they both list physical attractiveness as being important, but men tend to report that it's more important to them than women do. So if we have them rank order them in some way, women will not say that physical attractiveness is as important in a potential partner as men would say. Now, we'll talk later about some potential reasons why that might be. But on a survey, we do see a difference here. However, when it comes to behavior, we don't see that much of a difference. So what this means is that it seems like physical attractiveness is equally important across genders when it comes to behavior. However, it means that either women are not aware of how important physical attractiveness is to them, or perhaps it's a social desirability bias where they are afraid to put down that it's important to them because they don't want to be judged, because we do kind of have a double standard here for women. Maybe perhaps we expect men to say that physical attractiveness is important, but women might feel like it is somehow different when they do it. So there is a difference that we see on surveys when it comes to attitudes, but we don't see that difference in behavior. So then what is attractive? We said that our characteristics that are important to us, physical attraction is definitely one of those. So what is it that makes someone attractive? Well, for this, they surveyed men and asked them what characteristics they found most attractive. So highly attractive female faces tended to include large eyes, small nose, small chin, prominent cheekbones. There are some more on the next slide. What is it that comes to mind when I say this? Large eyes, small nose, small chin, female, right? Prominent cheekbones. For me, the first thing that comes to mind is a Disney princess, right? Like, take a second, pause this video, pull up the internet, and Google Anna and Elsa, okay? And just look at a picture. They have extremely large eyes that take up the vast majority of their face, very small nose, small chin, prominent cheekbones, right? Also, narrow cheeks, high eyebrows, large pupils, big smile. This sounds like a Disney princess. Now, then I ask the question, is it that we find these characteristics attractive because that is what is modeled in Disney movies? Or is it that this is what we find attractive and so Disney is now modeling that after whatever is the quote-unquote ideal female face? It's difficult to say which came first, the chicken or the egg, but we see that these characteristics that men are ranking as attractive do look similar, to a lot of cartoon versions of females. So, not to leave the men out here, they also asked women to rate male faces and to say what they thought was most attractive. Large eyes, prominent cheekbones, and big smile also made the list for men, but here we have large chin instead of a small chin. We see the big smile is important. It's listed for both genders. I think that it is not just that a smile looks attractive, but also that we feel like there's something there that tells us about their personality. Although looks can be deceiving, but big smile, large eyes seem to be attractive on both genders here. And so then perhaps this is something that we are teaching people about how to find things attractive, what to find attractive through Disney, or maybe Disney is modeling after real life. Who knows? One thing that we see that is important for an attractive face is similarity across cultures is symmetry. So when we're talking about different cultures all around the world, they find a lot of different things attractive. I think we talked about this already when we talked about like weight being different, like the ideal weight and body type being different across the world, but there are several things that are different in different cultures. Like, for example, in some Asian cultures, they find small feet attractive. So women would like bind their feet to try to make them smaller, which I would just be out of luck in that situation. When I was in high school and bought basketball shoes, I had to go to the men's section always. So I wouldn't fit in those cultures. But we know that there are a lot of cultural differences, but one thing that is similar across cultures is symmetry. So symmetry just meaning that one side of the face is matching the other side of the face. It says the size, shape, and location of the features on one side match the other side of the face. So typically, when we look at the faces that are ranked as most beautiful, they have people look through pictures and give a rating of some kind. The faces that are most symmetrical are typically seen as being most attractive across cultures. So, talking about things that we find attractive, and we already talked a little bit about how we like people who like us. That comes back into play here. Attractiveness and familiarity. Familiarity may be a crucial variable. People prefer faces that most resemble their own. So we like other people that like us because we like us, and we like other people that look like us because we like us. The way they do this research is that they would get pictures of the participants ahead of time, and then they would use computer magic to alter that face to resemble the other gender, but keeping a lot of the same major characteristics, and people were most attracted to the altered pictures of themselves. And so there are a couple of things here. Either A, we just have high self-esteem and we like the way we look, and so we appreciate those traits on other people. Or perhaps it's just familiarity. We are used to looking at ourselves. And so there's something familiar about it that we like. Whatever the case may be, we seem to be attracted to ourselves. So maybe that's just the American individualistic selfie culture that we live in. Very good. Moving on. Okay, so we're talking about attraction and we're talking about specifically physical attraction and how this sometimes can be misleading. People tend to attribute positive qualities to beautiful people. So when we talk about an attribution, we're just talking about a cause. So we tend to look at people and say that people who are attractive, we also associate that with other positive qualities. This what is beautiful is good stereotype. So a stereotype, which we'll talk more about later when we talk about prejudice, but a stereotype is just a belief that we have about someone based on their group membership. So a stereotype is intended to save us a lot of time and effort. If I feel like I know something about you based solely on your group membership, then I don't have to get to know you. I can just assume that I already do. Obviously, there are a lot of problems with stereotypes, which we'll get into more later, but a stereotype is just a belief you have about someone because they're in a certain group. So when you see someone who's highly attractive, obviously we can say that person is highly attractive, but that's not all that we say about that person. We have a stereotype, we have a belief about them. Even if we don't know them, we feel like we do. So, the beautiful are thought to be more sociable, extroverted, popular, sexual, happy, assertive. Think about that for a second. They showed people pictures of individuals that had ahead of time been rated as attractive, and they said, "How sociable do you think this person is? How extroverted do you think this person is? So outgoing, likes to be around people, popular, sexual? How sexual do you think this person is?" And people tended to say that the attractive faces had more of these characteristics. Now, on the one hand, this is a stereotype. Obviously, you can't judge a book by its cover. You don't know by looking at a person how happy they are, or how outgoing they are, or how popular they are. You don't know that information. However, perhaps there is a grain of truth here that people who are highly attractive may be more likely to be popular. Because people like spending time around attractive people. People who are highly attractive people might be happier because they might have more positive interactions with other people, right? So there may be some small amount of truth to this, but for the most part, this is a great way to make some major mistakes, right? So, however, as I said, there is a little bit of truth to this stereotype. Highly attractive people do develop better social skills than more average-looking people, right? So they do have better social skills than the rest of us. They report having more satisfying interactions with others. But this does not necessarily mean that there is just something genetic about having good looks and there's something genetic about having good social skills and that they're just blessed with both. That's not exactly what this means. A self-fulfilling prophecy is the idea that when we believe something, we behave in a way that makes it true. So perhaps if this individual who's highly attractive, other people look at that person and say, he or she must be really fun to be around, must be really sociable, must be really extroverted, must be really happy. So they treat that person as if they are, then that person will start to behave in those ways because that's how people treat them. And because they are now getting a great opportunity to have positive interactions with other people, at least more likely to be positive interactions than your more average looking person. And then they will also be more likely to develop these relationships and have a chance to practice their social skills so that they can develop them. So individuals who are highly attractive might get more opportunities to practice their social skills. Therefore, they become more sociable. So we have this self-fulfilling prophecy here. So there is a little bit of truth to this, but for the most part, we can't judge a book by its cover. So unfortunately, this can happen though, where we judge someone based on their appearance and we make assumptions about their intelligence or we make assumptions about their competence at their job, right? That is wrong, and we'll talk more about this when we talk about prejudice, but it happens because in general, we're lazy and we don't always want to get to know everyone. I'm sorry, but it's true. All right. So, when we're talking about the things that we find attractive and how we select our partners, there is an interesting theory, evolutionary psychology, and the basic idea here is that the goal of finding a mate and having relationships is to pass on our genetics, right? To have children. So those traits that contribute to passing on children are the one are having children and passing on your genes are the ones that are more likely to be passed on, and therefore they will continue to happen. This theory then, it could perhaps explain why there are some characteristics that men find more attractive, whereas there are some other different characteristics that women find more attractive. So this is not always the case, but typically when you ask men, they would say that physical attractiveness is some of the most important things to them. Whereas women would say that resources would be most important to them. So having a partner who is financially stable, perhaps, and can provide and care for her. Why might that be the case? Why would physical attractiveness be more important for a man looking for that in a woman, whereas resources are more important for a woman looking for that in a man? Well, perhaps this maximizes the chances of reproductive success, right? It could be that the traits that we consider physically attractive are actually traits that signify health. So then, if a man is looking for a physically attractive partner, what he's really looking for is a healthy looking partner. Why would a man be especially concerned with finding a healthy partner? Because he would, if we're talking just about evolutionary psychology and we care about passing on our genetics, then that individual would want a healthy partner who could carry his baby, give birth successfully, have a successful pregnancy, and then nurse the child, right? So perhaps if we're talking about reproductive success being the goal, then men would be more attracted to women who look like they could be healthy carriers of children. On the other hand, women, they are going to be the ones who are carrying the children. And women are not able to have as many children as men are. So it would be especially important for a woman then to find a partner who would have the resources to help her provide for her child so that her child is able to grow up and be successful. See, men can have as many children as they are willing to find, or they can find willing partners, right? Whereas women, within a span of a year, can only have one child, or maybe more if they have multiples, but it takes about a year between, you know, giving birth to the child, recovering from that, nursing, and that kind of thing. It takes about at least a year, and so a man could have many, many children in the span of a year. Woman can only have one. So then the woman has all, forgive the pun here, but has all of her eggs in one basket, so she needs a partner who will provide for her and give her resources. On the other hand, the man needs a partner who is attractive because she is healthy so that she can care for his child. So the idea here is that there may be gender differences because there are different reproductive dilemmas for men versus women, right? This is just one theory, right? I don't know that we can simplify it this much, but it's just one thought. Okay, so we've been talking about attraction up until this point. So now we've been attracted to the person, we've developed a relationship with the person, we've fallen in love with the person. So we're going to talk about different types of love. Now, in social psychology, I'm just going to touch briefly on the different types of love. There's a lot more information on this, and if you're interested, come by my office hours. I'd be happy to talk with you guys. But often when we think about love, it's something that we know what it means. We feel love, right? Even if we're not in love with someone, we know what love feels like. We love our family. We love our friends. So companionate love here is a type of love that has intimacy and affection, but not passion. So oftentimes, as I said, love is hard to define, but we talk about love often as having these building blocks of intimacy and commitment and passion. And intimacy is just like a psychological closeness to the person. You feel like you know them. You feel like you can trust them. You feel like you have this deep connection with them. So when someone has companionate love, they have that intimacy and they have the commitment as well, but they don't have the passion. So they don't experience a lot of physiological arousal. Now, if I were to ask you the question, what kinds of people do you have companionate love for? You might say your family members, you might say your friends, and that is certainly the case, that you can have companionate love in non-sexual relationships, just close friendships or family members. But it is also possible for you to have companionate love for someone who you do have a sexual relationship with, so perhaps a spouse or long-term partner. So this is someone who is in a relationship with the person. They feel committed to staying in that relationship. They feel intimacy, connection with that person, but they don't feel that heat or that passion. Perhaps they used to feel it, and then over time it changes. You know, if there's anything that research tells us about love, it's that it doesn't go on without changing. I'm not saying that love itself goes away, but love does change. And sometimes relationships fail because partners aren't prepared for this change. But oftentimes, companionate love is the love that lasts. It's a love that you feel when you've been with a partner for a long period of time. So this doesn't necessarily mean that your relationship has failed if it doesn't have a large amount of passion in it. Companionate love is still a very valid form of love. On the other hand, passionate love is that intense longing that we feel for someone, right? That, like, you want to hold a boombox over your head, walk 1,000 miles, crawl through glass in the desert to get to this person, you have to have them right now, right? That feeling that, like, is so close to pain when you're not with that person, right? Physiological arousal. When someone else loves us back, it's amazing. When it's not, we are depressed and we're in despair and we don't know what to do, right? Passionate love. This is what we think of maybe when you first get in a relationship with someone and you're first falling in love and what that feels like. If I asked you that question, which would you rather have? If you only could have one, would you rather have intimacy or passion? Like, what if for the rest of your life you could only choose one? There's no right or wrong answer to that question, but it's something to think about. We can't always have it all, right? We want it all. Disney movies say we can have it all. Nicholas Sparks movies say we can have it all, but I'm not sure how accurate those are. But when we're talking about passionate love, it often fades. Usually passionate love is what you feel at the beginning, and sometimes it lasts a very brief period of time, and sometimes it lasts for a long time, but usually it does fade, and it is replaced more with that companionate love, and that's okay. And that's kind of the natural way of things. And if we felt like this for the rest of our lives, I mean, I can't imagine that, like, you can't think about anything. You'd be totally distracted. You couldn't do anything. You just can't handle that level of love for that long. So often love changes over time. It doesn't mean it goes away. It just changes, right? When you're feeling this passionate love, you have that intense physiological arousal. You're attracted to this person. Shortness of breath, perhaps. You feel like you can't breathe. You feel weak in the knees. Your heart is racing. You have that kind of fight or flight reaction. But if there's anything we know about the fight or flight reaction, is that it doesn't last forever. That's why exposure therapy works. So if there's someone who's afraid of something, you put them in a room, make them come face to face with their fears, they will initially freak out, but your body can only handle that, like, totally freaking out, heart racing, blood pressure sky high for a short period of time, and then your body will become exhausted and will give up and it will go away. It's just the nature of the way that we are, that we can't experience this feeling forever, and maybe we wouldn't want to, but it is really nice when it happens, right? So passionate love is important. Now, when I say that relationships change and that passionate love often decreases, I'm not saying that passion is gone forever. Sometimes it waxes and wanes and it can go away and it can come back, but relationships are hard work and you have to be prepared for that. Okay? Spoiler alert. So culture and love. Love is a universal emotion. If you talk to anyone anywhere in the world, they've heard of love. They may call it something different. They may experience it differently. They may have different expectations about it. But love is love, and people feel it everywhere. However, as I said, there are some major differences from one culture to another. And I asked this question, if you were going to study what love was like in another culture and you didn't know anything about that culture, how would you study their experience of love? Maybe you would interview couples. Maybe you would, you know, talk to people. Maybe you would read their romance novels and listen to their songs and watch their movies, and that could tell you a lot. So imagine that you were a researcher from a different culture and you were trying to find out how we viewed love in our culture. What would you do? Well, you sit down and watch all the Nicholas Sparks movies and you know, all that. What would you find about love in our culture? Well, in our culture, the media, it's a lot about sex. It's a lot about unrealistic expectations, and it's probably low in commitment. We'll talk more next week about how the divorce rate is 50%, flip a coin, and that's perhaps something that we created because of the way that we look at relationships in our society. But I'll talk more about that next week. But definitely cultures have different experiences of love and expectations about love. Like, for example, in our culture, you probably expect to pick your own partner. But in other cultures, they have arranged marriages, or they have situations where the family as a unit chooses a spouse. To us, that seems totally strange, but to them, it seems strange that we choose our own partners. Like, that's such a big decision. Wouldn't you want your family's input? It's just different. It doesn't mean that one way is right and one way is wrong. It just seems strange to us if we're looking at a different culture. The way that they experience love is just different from us, right? Romantic love is nearly universal in our human species. But our rules alter how that emotional state is experienced and expressed and remembered. So as I said, just as an example, arranged marriage, how you get into the relationship may vary from place to place. But also, what you do in that relationship is important. And as I said, we'll talk about divorce next week, but the way that the culture views divorce also impacts the way that the culture views marriage and how they view relationships in general, whether it is perhaps taboo or unthought of or unheard of to end a relationship in that culture will change the way that you approach marriage and could even possibly increase commitment. One thing that I talk about in my relationships class at MSU is what would happen if we outlawed divorce? I know that's a strange thought, but just think about that for a second. Like, if we got rid of divorce completely, would that make marriage better? Some people would say, no, I wouldn't get married if I didn't have that option. I wouldn't. But on the other hand, think about this. If you knew that divorce was not an option, then perhaps people would put more effort into choosing their partners. Perhaps they would put more effort into staying with their partners and be more committed because, I mean, I'm here, so I might as well work hard at it and try to make it happy. Just something to think about. But the culture that you're raised in really influences the way that you see love and the way that you think about love. Okay? So that is all the lecture for this week. So remember that you have the activity that's going to be due by Friday at 5 p.m. Let me know if you have any questions. Next week, we will finish up the section on love and attraction, and then we will also start talking about prejudice next week. So if you need anything, let me know. Otherwise, I will talk to you guys later.